So as leader, I've had the chance to travel across this vast and beautiful country. And I've got to meet a lot of amazing people. But more important than just meeting people, I've got to hear their stories and listen to their concerns. And I've got a sense that more and more Canadians, more and more families, are feeling a bit uncertain about the future. They're feeling worried. They're feeling unstable about where things are going. And people are being told on one side that the economy is booming, that things are going well, that things are chugging along, things are great. But then people aren't really feeling that in their own lives. People start to worry if the economy is going so well and it's working, who is it working for? Because it doesn't feel like it's working for me. Well, they'd be right to think that. The gap between the rich and the rest of us is only getting wider. And those at the top don't know what it's like for the rest of Canadians. In fact, last year, 82% of the wealth generated, 82% went to the top 1%, the wealthiest people in this world. That means what people were feeling is absolutely correct. That means most of the wealth that was generated, most of the economic growth didn't go to everyday people. I'm reminded of the time my father fell ill and when he was unable to work and times were tough. And I remember that feeling in our family. We were worried. We were worried about what tomorrow would bring. We were worried about the future, and if I'm honest, I was afraid. And I know no one wants that kind of uncertainty for themselves, for their kids, certainly not for their grandkids. Personne ne veut être dans l'insécurité de vivre.
No one wants to live in insecurity, but too many people are faced with it. A Ipsos survey says that over half the population in Canada is $200 or less away from not being able to pay their bills at the end of the month. Imagine, that's half the population. And things are not getting any better. On the contrary, the revenue gaps and the lack of opportunities are always increasing. We're moving backwards.
Seize on that insecurity and use that to drive a wedge between people who should be allies. Some leaders use our fears to benefit themselves and the powerful and the wealthy and their friends instead of real people. They want you to think that the only way you get ahead is if you go it alone, that working together holds us back rather than lifts us up. They want you to believe that the government is the enemy and the cause of your, and that taxes just take something away from you, rather than giving something back to all of us. They don't want you to believe that government belongs to all of us and together we can solve our problems. Because that allows them to continue to rig the system so that it works better for the wealthy and the powerful and their friends, better than it works for the rest of us. As a kid, I'll tell you a lot of stories about my mom, but as a kid, my mom told me that we're all connected, that there's this thread that binds us together, that when one of us is suffering, she taught me that all of us are suffering, and that if we lift up the people around us, we all rise. That affected the choices I made as a kid, as a lawyer, and as a leader. It drives me every day, this belief. Mom, I know you are in the crowd somewhere here. You're gonna love to hear this, but I think many Canadians agree with you. She's pretty cute. She's right over here somewhere.
Nous sommes tous reliés. Tout ce que nous faisons comme
everything we do, we're all related, and everything we do together will affect the rest of the people. And that's what we have to show people. It's better to make better choices to get better results. We can reduce inequalities instead of letting them get bigger. We can help people obtain services more easily instead of making it more difficult. And we can stop this wealth concentration between so few hands instead of making sure we have an economy that works for everybody. We want an economy that everyone could enjoy, not only a few of us.
They deserve more than just empty words with no follow-through. Like with climate change and the environment, people know that this is a massive issue of our generation, that we need to do something about it now, that promises to reduce emissions betray the trust that we have that we want to do something about making it better. And when this government talks about reducing emissions and doesn't, it lets people down who want to see better. And when it comes to electoral reform, people want to see a system that gives power to the people. They don't want to And when a government betrays that trust, when a government betrays the trust of the people who want to see an electoral system that truly puts people first, that truly reflects the desires and the will of the people, that lets down people. And that's why we will not let that happen. We will commit to implementing proportional representation to give people the power they deserve, to ensure that people have a voice in our country, to make sure their government reflects them. Friends, the time for timid is over. Too many people have waited for too long. They're counting on us, and we must not let them down. We need to win. We need to have the courage to get the job done. Now, there's so many areas that I'm sure we can all think about. If we had the courage, if our government had the courage to do what was right, we could make people's lives better. I want to touch on a couple of those areas.
Les gens devraient pouvoir gagner. People should be able to earn a living, have dreams, be able to support their families and retire in dignity. The reality is that too often their work is very precarious, especially for the youth. Low salaries, precarious employment, low benefits, this feeling of being constantly at risk. Just look at what happened to the employees and retirees of Sears. We have a huge business here that went bankrupt. But instead of paying those who dedicated their lives for this company during decades, instead of paying their salaries, their health benefits, and their pension, Sears first handed bonuses to management people.
Financiers, banks get their loans paid back. Sears executives get their bonuses, while workers lose the pensions they've worked for their entire lives. And what's the Prime Minister's answer? Get used to it. We're not going to get used to it. We're going to change the laws to make sure working people's pensions are put first, are protected, so their salaries, their benefits, their wages are protected.
Thanks. I'm going to keep going. I got much more to go.
To tackle inequality, to really get at inequality, we need to tackle a rigged tax system that benefits the ultra-rich, and we need to make sure that corporations and the wealthiest contribute their fair share. That's what we need to do. Taxes are investments into building a fair society for us all. An example
of inequalities is when the web giants are exempted from income tax here, while our Canadian companies don't have the same fiscal benefits. Why? Think about the secret agreement with Netflix. Do you think it's normal to give an American business the responsibility of developing Canadian cultural content? Well, the agreement with Netflix doesn't include any guarantee on Francophone content or Aboriginal content. It never says that our actors or companies will be protected. The industry was clear. We had to have an equal playing field for all. But the government did the opposite with rules that are benefiting foreign businesses and other rules for local or Canadian businesses. It's not normal.
In a country as big as ours, we depend on good infrastructure. It's something that connects us. It brings us together. It's how we move around. How we build, use, and have access to that infrastructure can either help or hurt equality in our country and for people. Like I said, we need to be connected. Our infrastructure connects us. We need to use the roads and bridges, our airports, our public transit to stay connected, to move around. If we can't use it, if we can't afford it, if it doesn't work, we lose our connections. So when we talk about building infrastructure, we must put as a priority quality and access for people first, not profits. Privatization means that we lose control, that infrastructure doesn't work for people. This also applies to technology. How many people here remember when we used to call the internet the information highway? Folks, remember that? I'm totally aging myself here. Totally dating, like he's no longer cool. I think I am, but anyways, I do remember. It was called the information highway. But it's true. It's a way that we connect not only with our neighbors, not only with our friends and our communities, but it's how we connect with the world. So I believe we should look at internet connectivity as a public infrastructure. We should look at it. Absolutely. We need to build it for rural communities. We need to build it across our country, make it accessible, make it affordable, and make it high quality. Absolutely. Thank you. That is pretty cool. You can tell I love public infrastructure. I really believe in it. I'm glad that you gave a standing ovation for something as important as that. I believe in it. Thank you. It's critical for people to realize that we need to keep our infrastructure in public hands. That's the only way to make sure that it works for us people. We own it. It's ours. We can't sell it off or we'll never get it back. That's why we must defend it, invest in it, build it. Let's keep it public for the people. It's ours. That's right.
you, my friends.
As Canadians, we also need to renew our commitment to complete the promise of truly universal health care. And I don't want to make an argument here. It's essential. Universal health care is essential when we talk about equality for all Canadians. And I'm reminded of that. I was reminded of that when I had a chance to speak with Bernie Sanders last fall. Now, definitely. I love that people are just jumping up and they want to get up on everything. I appreciate that. No, he's great. So we were chatting about public health care, and of course, you know, he's fighting for universal health care in the United States. And in fact, his plan goes further than our plan. And he reminded me, you know, the spirit of why we fought for health care in the first place, why Tommy Douglas had this dream, why we believe so much in universal health care. For us, universal health care is a tool to tackle inequality. In Canada, it used to happen, it still happens in the States, but people would get ill, and they couldn't work because they were ill. And they couldn't afford their medication, they couldn't afford their bills, they couldn't afford to get better. So people would get further into debt and often go into bankruptcy. So it exacerbated inequality, it made inequality worse. So people were losing not only their health, but then all their resources. So when we look at the erosion of public health care, what that means is the rise of privatized healthcare. And that means the rich get the very best of care and the rest of us get what's left. It's an attack on equality. And already across our country, we're seeing a patchwork of coverage that puts people at risk. And that's why we need to recommit to using and looking at social universal healthcare as a tool to combat inequality. We need to have a champion for better public healthcare. We need to commit to not just defending it, we need to expand it. We need to commit today to implementing universal pharmacare in our country so that seniors get the medication they need. So parents can assure their kids are healthy. So no one is forced to choose between medicine and food. And on universal healthcare or universal pharmacare, I gotta give a shout out to Andrea, who's leading the charge provincially, the way Tommy did it in Saskatchewan. Andrea's gonna do it for us here in Ontario. But I also wonder, and I want you to wonder with me, why is it that only some parts of our body are covered by our healthcare system while other parts aren't? Right? Isn't it kind of odd? I ask you, to ask any health professional you know, and I'm sure they'll tell you that people live longer, healthier, better lives when they have good teeth. So why aren't we looking beyond expanding to pharmacare and look to including dental care as a part of our universal healthcare system? And then further on to eye care. Together with true universal healthcare, we are all healthier, we are all stronger, and a more vibrant society, my friends. Thank you. I kind of heard Jagmeet Singh and NDP blending together, and I love that. That sounds awesome. That's the win right there. It's also time for us to demand better solutions and more solutions to the affordable housing crisis in our country. If you think about it, probably one of the most important things that you can say in your life is having a place that you can call home. That's such an important part of your life. And everywhere I go, it's not limited to certain regions, everywhere I go, people are talking about housing not being affordable. I remember being in my kind of home province of Newfoundland, Labrador. Shout out to Newfoundland, Labrador. Anyone here? Yeah? All right. We got a small and mighty contingency. I was at Memorial University of Newfoundland, known as MUN, if you're in the know. And I was speaking with some students, and they shared with me their concerns. And they weren't just talking about concerns about buying a home when they got older. They were worried about even finding a place to rent. It's truly a national crisis across our country in every region. People are worried about housing. Now, the government says, we acknowledge that it's a national crisis. But I ask you, ask yourself this question. When they wait 2 years to do anything, do they really believe it's a crisis? How many times in your life have you had a crisis? You're like, I got this crisis. I'm gonna wait 2 years to do something about it, but it's a serious crisis. I'm pretty sure it was either not a crisis or you did not wait 2 years. Nous devons investir dans le logement social, dans les coops.
We must invest in social housing, in co-ops. We must build affordable housing with a special attention to building rental units. And we must eliminate speculation that is pushing the prices up in Canada. In Aboriginal communities, we must have units that respect everybody's culture. We must give more control to the Aboriginal communities because they know better than us what they need. When we talk about the housing crisis and the fight against homelessness, too many people are left behind. Too many people are left waiting. We must do more. We will do more now.
When people look at the problems they face in their lives, they look at those problems and then they look at what the government has done, or in most cases has not done, it's hard not to get cynical. Many people start to think that maybe the government itself is the problem. I get that. I used to think that for a long time. I didn't think that government could, would, or even cared to do anything that was right for people. I remember working with organizations and we were pushing from the outside. I was pushing and demanding that the government do more to end poverty, to stand up for those who needed support, those most vulnerable in our society, refugees and immigrants, to end racism, to help people instead of hurting them. Then the people that I worked with, they convinced me that we needed a partner in government to make choices that would actually benefit people. If I'm honest, I was still pretty skeptical though. I didn't see it. I didn't see how we could do it. But I was inspired by a couple of folks. I was inspired by Jack Layton and his belief in people and that government could be a source of good for people's lives. What I learned from Jack and then other examples that were kind of pointed out to me was that we could make a difference. In fact, if you think about it, it's our government. It's our resources. It's not only possible to get the changes we want, it's what government must do. It's what government should be doing. Don't let them tell you it can't be done. Je sais que les choses peuvent être.
I know that things can be tough for people, for families. I know that it may be difficult to struggle when we're faced with some problems, some issues, that is, to fight to improve things. Many of us can be discouraged, frustrated, because it's difficult to predict or see any changes. But I think that by focusing on the relationships that we have and also our love for the planet and nature, I think we can face this challenge together.
My mom, I like telling stories about my mom. She's pretty awesome. So she taught me this idea of Chardikala. It's a phrase, and it means rising spirits. So if you ask her how she's doing, she'd say Chardikala. So one day she asked me, she's like, Jagmeet, how are you doing? And I said, oh, Chardikala. And then she said, why? I'm like, oh, it's like a test. And I'm like, because it's nice outside, it's a good day, I'm happy, I'm excited, things are going well. And she looked at me, like moms do. That's not Chardikala. I'm like, oh, why not? Like, what is it? It's like, Chardikala is a courageous sense of optimism when things aren't going right, in the face of difficulty, in the face of hard times, and when you're losing hope, it's keeping that spirit alive. That's Chardikala. Like, whoa, mom, that's pretty deep. That's pretty awesome. And then I thought, there's something really new democratic about that, right? About that idea of tapping into courageous spirits when times are tough. It's kind of like what we need to do all the time. Because times are pretty tough, right? But really, if you think about it, that's the spirit that we need to take on some of the biggest challenges of inequality that we're faced with. And one of those massive areas of inequality is the inequality faced by Indigenous peoples. The inequality and the injustice. And I know there's so many areas of inequality and so many areas of injustice. I just want to touch on just recently, I know many of us, a lot of us, maybe all of us in this room, were rattled and shaken by the Colton Bushi case just recently in Saskatchewan. It shook a lot of us, a young Indigenous man that was killed. And I had the chance to meet with the family. And sitting down with Colton Bushi's mom, his uncle, and his sister, I was really touched by the way they described how they felt. I remember listening to Jade, Colton's sister, describing the frustration and the unfairness and the inequality and just how horrible it was that Colton's mom, when it was informed about the death of her son, she was treated like a criminal by the police. And the way they came into her home and surrounded it and made her feel like she had done something wrong. And I remember the strength that Jade showed, that she was sharing this sad moment and she was torn by the sadness, but also she was indignant and powerful in that moment. And I was inspired by her. And I remember listening to Colton's uncle and how he said, you know, I had hope. I had a feeling of hope that maybe we could see some justice. And that at the end of the case, he felt like he was knifed in the back and betrayed. And the family talked about how the message of Indigenous lives being disposable was a message that continued to be perpetuated in society. And this was another example. But I was inspired by their courage. They wanted to fight, not just for justice for Colton, but justice for all Indigenous youth. They wanted to tackle the systemic discrimination that exists in our society. I was inspired by them. It's that same feeling, though, of the disposable nature of Indigenous lives that makes the missing and murdered Indigenous Women's and Girls March that happened this week so important as a way to denounce and reject that notion and to celebrate the sanctity, the sacred value of lives. Inequality is something that grips our country in many ways. It impacts women in our society, continues to impact women with pay equity. It's a shame that in our country, women still receive only 70 to 80% of the salary for the exact same job as a man. It's unacceptable. But inequality as it impacts women is broader than that. It impacts society in a wider way. It's appalling to me, I can't even sometimes fathom it, that the majority of women in Canada have faced some form of discrimination in their lives. And that's what makes the Me Too movement so powerful. It's an opportunity for us to grow, for us to build a better society where women are safe in every aspect of life. But it's an opportunity for us to look inwards and to grow as well. For me, it's given me an opportunity to look at the limitations of addressing something through a strict legal analysis, that it's not enough to look at this problem through a legal lens if you want to change the status quo, if you want to make this society better and a better place. That's something I'm committed to doing, and I think we need to do that together. It's going to be tough, though, but good things are tough, and change is difficult, and growth is difficult, but it's something we must do. One of the other things that we see a connection between inequality is discrimination, racism. It exacerbates existing inequality. And I know that feeling of not belonging because of the way you look. I know how that makes you feel, to feel like you don't belong. But it also has impacts on inequality. And one of those most pernicious forms of racism is anti-black racism. It's real, it must be named, and it has devastating consequences on our society. It impacts educational outcomes, it impacts the justice system, it impacts access to resources and access to power. So we must denounce it and we must work against it. In fact, all these forms of discrimination, whether it's racism, specifically anti-black racism, anti-Semitism, hate is like a fire. Once allowed to grow, it spreads, consuming all. And that's why we must stop it in its tracks together. We must stand united to denounce hate and to stand up for love, to build a society where we celebrate everyone's identity, where we stand up for all together. That's the world we want to build.
Whether it was the terrorist attack in Quebec City, Islamophobia, or hateful populism, we have the responsibility to tackle intolerance and discrimination everywhere at all times. Dignity brings us together. All the religions, every color, and every gender, whoever you love or whoever you are.
Just gonna get some water real quick here. Is that awkward? One sec here. You know things are going good when someone cheers you for getting water. Equality means really building that world where everyone feels like they belong, and that's something we need to do together, my friends. And we're gonna keep on going. Keep on going. It's good right there. That was good right there. Some folks know what I'm doing right now. It's a little bit awkward. Canadians believe that all good things come, that we can build good things when we work together. People need their government to have the courage to tackle the problems rather than saying that it can't be done. We can't tackle inequality without naming the problems. We can't hide from the truth, and we can't claim that things are good enough. My friends, this is not as good as it gets. Governments belong to us, and it should be making choices that build an economy that works better for all of us. Saying get used to it is not good enough for Canadians. We won't just get used to it. We won't be afraid. We won't be silent.
We deserve so much better than the same old lines that we've heard too often. Together, we can do so much better, my friends.
Realize we are all in this together, my friends. And it takes an act of courage to demand better, to dream bigger, and build that better world we know is possible together. It's up to us, my friends. So speak up. Talk to your families. Talk to your neighbors. Talk to your friends. Show them that a better way is possible. Let's care more about each other. Let's demand better for Canadians. Let's be champions for people. Let's do this. Let's get it done, my friends. Thank you.
We're ready. Yeah, we're ready.